Hello, hello, everybody. It is 8:01 a.m. Central Time on the 18th of May, 2018. That's a lot of eights. And we are here on Friday, going into Saturday internationally. Hope you're doing well. Here to talk about a few seismic events that have developed since last night. Did my update last night at 10 p.m. Save that over on YouTube. And since then, we've really started to go up again. And when I say go up, I'm talking about the number of earthquakes and the magnitudes in each location. If you're not aware, last night, yesterday, we saw a series of 6.0 earthquakes strike the Southwest Pacific, and then that dipped down into upper fives, 5.8, 5.6, 5.7, 6.0, 6.1, 6.2, 6.3. And that's where we are now in the West Pacific, and that's just the tip of the iceberg. That's where we were last night. Now, since then, since last night, that's when all these fives started to develop. So first, the sixes hit, and then going up to the north from there, we see a series of fives going up to Tonga and Fiji and over to the west at New Caledonia. When we go to the west from there, we have a 4.8 from yesterday going into this morning as well in the Solomon Islands. After that, over to the west, nothing since last night. The whole West Pacific silent when it comes to seismic activity in the last 12 hours. That's not good. As we go up to the north, and the reason that's not good is in a seismically prone area that's this wide, where we have multiple volcanic eruptions taking place in Japan and Indonesia, that we would expect seismic activity to accompany that. So as we go to the north then, here's a 4.7 after last night's 5.8 at Hokkaido. So another 4.7 has hit. Now, this is near 6.0 in its own right for Japan. Take it a step down, and we got a 5.3 that hit yesterday off the coast of Tokyo. Okay, so that's what's going on in the West Pacific right now. We are going back up in magnitudes, especially over here next to where our deep earthquakes have been shaking the region up. Our deep earthquakes are raised high off the globe, so you can see them pretty easily. And we've got a set here, and then we've got another set over to the west. And that's, I think, why we're getting so much activity striking next to each location. For my Aussie viewers, down here, guys, you're hit on both sides of Australia with almost the exact same size of activity, 2.0 and 2.2. This follows your deep earthquakes up to the north, and then that push that came across the center of the plate. You guys remember, it started here, where our arrow is, and then went down and across over to here. It really did. It's amazing. So as we look at this, just take a look at what's going on here. Oh, by the way, this arrow hardly ever gets hit. Hardly ever gets hit, but when there's a great amount of force. And it got hit this past week. But we get down to New Zealand and your 6.0 activity to your north. We are expecting an increase from the North Island down to the Cook Strait. So North Island here, and I think it's pretty obvious we are going up in the number of events. Now, magnitudes on this, south tip of the island last night went up to 3.9. Today, it's all in the 2 range. We're at 2.6. I think the highest we went is 3.5. So in between here, we're in 2s to 3s, and the biggest is at Kaikoura, north of Christchurch. However, there is new activity just west of Christchurch in Canterbury, the Canterbury mountain range going into the Southern Alps. Now let's get out here into Hawaii. Guys, Hawaii yesterday, boom, huge blast, as the side of the crater of Kilauea collapsed in at some point down in the tube, caused a little bit of blockage. It fell thousands of feet down into the volcano, and then it blew up. So it was a little different than a steam blast. I'm going to go ahead and turn on a display capture at this point so you can see what I see, and we'll come back over here. So since yesterday, we still have an ongoing swarm. The swarm starts at Kilauea and then goes all the way down to the coast. Then we have a pocket over at the southeast tip, east-southeast of Lalani Estates. In between where the cluster is here and the cluster is here, that's where our fissures are breaking out. And there's now a 21st fissure is open, and a previous fissure, I think 17 or was it 3? I there's so many now. We're talking 20 different breakpoints that have split open as the magma is trying to force its way up, but it's also trying to follow a path of least resistance outwards. And as it's going out into the ocean. There's no doubt about that. And that's what's going on out in the ocean. All these earthquakes that are striking along the coast, about 100 miles, 150 miles of area that where is no doubt about it, draining out deep down below. There may even be some pumice that starts washing ashore. Now, there is something I do need to show you. Okay, we're going to go look up this 3.0 earthquake. Well, you know, I told you I was going to keep monitoring this situation, and if I saw anything, I would tell you, right? Okay. So, come along with me on this little journey of discovery as we go to Hawaii. Now, the reason I'm showing this to you, I promised I would show you if I saw something that was going on that was significant. A new 3.0 earthquake has now struck on the flanks of Mauna Loa, in between Mauna Loa and Kilauea. Now, the tourist center is right over here on the flanks of the crater, right here. And down below the tourist center, there was an earthquake swarm. And yesterday, you guys saw it at this inner crater, blue. This thing drained down thousands of feet, went beyond view, and it's still way, way, way down in there, thousands of feet down. And the tube that makes this up started to collapse on the sides, and each time it collapses, it blows. And then this is the greater crater. So inside the crater, there's a smaller crater, and that's the thing that's putting off all the smoke right now and all the steam and, you know, ash clouds and so forth. But this greater crater here is actually inside of another greater crater. So really, you got a crater, crater, and a crater within a crater. So three craters. And those three craters, the one in the middle is the one that's giving us all the trouble right now. Now, if this bigger crater were to collapse, that would be something that would be really, really significant for Hawaii or even in the whole Pacific. That would be something really, really significant. But that's not happening right now. Instead, what's happening is we're seeing earthquakes spread out from Kilauea, like I said, going down to the coast, out to sea, but it's also going around Mauna Loa. And just a day and a half ago, we were at Mauna Kea. Altogether, I'm going to have to say Mauna Loa, Mauna Kea, Kilauea, and Pu'u'o'o, they have to be tied together at some point or very close to it down below. Now, no professional. I've watched everything I can find, and man, I've been looking to see if they would even just talk about it. You know, just to mention that there's some earthquakes hitting at Mauna Loa and Mauna Kea all of a sudden. Hush, hush. Don't want to cause any panic. Well, I'm going to tell you guys something. I don't want to cause any panic either. I'm going to tell you right now, Hawaii's okay. Hawaii is, you know, people are like, oh, we're going to have a tsunami. We're going to fall into the ocean. When's Hawaii going to fall in the ocean? Not anytime soon. You can see the sloping angles of the slopes here. And there's not much for it to fall into, guys. I'm just saying. I mean, yes, there is a drop-off, but in order for it to fall, it's got to have somewhere to fall. And it's got mounds on all sides, over millennia of magma building up on all sides. It's not going anywhere. And to top it all off, the ash clouds that are being produced out of Kilauea are blowing this way, out to sea, over the small rural populated areas where people know they're living on old lava flows. Whereas over to the west and the cities and so forth, and all the other Hawaiian islands. I mean, guys, I mean, come on, man. Hawaii is totally fine. And I don't get anything for recommending it. I don't get any kind of tourist bucks, and nobody's telling me what to say. I'm telling you that if I could go there, I would go there. And it's not just because I'm into earthquakes and volcanoes, although that would be awesome. Right now, I don't even think you can go to the park right now. So, I mean, if you wanted to go, it's fine. If you wanted to see something cool, you could go and see the ash clouds from far away and all that good stuff. And this is normal for Hawaii to top it all off. Think of this. This is the greatest right here, okay? Mauna Loa, it erupted in 1983. So, I mean, we've seen bigger events in the past. I just got to put it in perspective. So, if I see earthquakes starting to creep up in magnitudes around Mauna Loa, that's what's going on now. It started in the 2 range. Now we're going up into the 3 range. And we're going around the volcano from the southwest tip to the northeast tip, which means the magma chamber for down below at Mauna Loa is being slightly perturbed. And professionals don't want to tell you that because they're too worried about you freaking out. Well, I don't think you're going to freak out. I think you're going to use the information to understand what's going on. And this will help you to also understand that in the past, there has to have been times in the past when all of these were going at once. And I'm talking in human history. I'm not talking about back of the dinosaurs. I'm talking about, now, in the past few thousand years or less, that we've seen this go before, and it didn't cause, end of the world scenario or big tsunamis across the entire Pacific, or even so much so in Hawaii sometimes. Now, sometimes there are undersea mount collapses that do cause localized waves. Like this, for instance. This is about 3,000 feet high. Okay, so we go, 1,500 feet high, 2,000 feet high. So if this collapses, it's a 2,000 foot high undersea mount, or this one right here. You might see this one, it's a cone on the undersea bed. It goes up 1,000, 1,500 feet. Some of them are even bigger. This thing collapses, or let's say magma starts coming out of this and lava pours out the side and it starts to grow, and then it gets to a tipping point or it's on an angle and the thing breaks off. Okay, that can cause a tsunami here. Not across the Pacific, just at Hawaii. Now, that's happened before and it can happen again, but guess what usually causes that to slip and slide and break? Big earthquakes. So it's not like it's just the magma that comes out and builds up and then the thing gets top heavy somehow and falls over. No, the water weight and the way magma flows, it always seeks out flow out down and out to the sides. It's a compression that happens due to the weight of the water on top of the fluid magma that comes out as lava. So when this collapses, if it collapses, something like this, it can cause a wave, and that's what people might be worried about. But we're going out along the coast 100-something miles where the magma is coming out in lava tubes. And if it's coming out that way, then it's not building up in a single undersea mount. It's going across a huge distance, coating the entire seafloor. Now, another thing that I would start to guess, there's probably going to be some pumice that's going to be floating around out here, guys. It's got to be. Either that or the ocean currents. It could be possible that the ocean currents are flowing along Hawaii this way and then taking any pumice that could be coming out floating in the water and taking it out this way. And, you'd have to have a shipping lane or somebody flying over and seeing it for a vast distance for that to be going on. It could also be that the magma that's coming out is not producing, or the lava that's coming out, is not producing that floating type pumice. It's maybe a different type of lava flow, which can happen in Hawaii as well. All right, so that's our Hawaii update. I've got to take the time to do that because there's a lot of, I don't know, opportunism from the mainstream media to, inflame an issue. But, the blast yesterday was big. Don't get me wrong, 30,000 foot high is pretty big. But it was due to the interior portion of the magma chamber collapsing, the tube. Not some kind of weird event or anything. We would expect this. When the magma drains down, the sides become weak, sides start to collapse in, you get explosions. Let's go talk about Central America. What hit since last night? Well, take a look at it. Mexico swarming out with fours all of a sudden. We went from threes to mid-range fours. So that's about a 200% increase in power. We're talking a big increase going on here. Going out of threes, going to fours. Same time that's all going on, going out of low fours, going into mid fours, or upper threes, going into fours. Mexico erupting, also down to the south. Reventador erupting. Well, centered in between them, a new 5.4 to 5.5 earthquake has just struck in the past few minutes, the past 30 minutes, down here off the coast of Colombia and Ecuador. Now, we need to go back several days to see the silent zone here. Here's a 5.2 that goes back to yesterday and then today's fours, or we take it back just a step more and our red-colored earthquakes from the previous day, 4.9 and 4.6. Either way, we are centered directly between the previous sets of earthquakes with a new 5.4. This is another perfect example of a fulcrum point being hit between two areas that are thousands of miles apart, and it happened within a day's time. We'll go down here to the South Atlantic, and X marks the spot. New 5.0 earthquake struck down here at the South Sandwich Islands, and out here on the South Mid-Atlantic Ridge, a 5.4. So, 4.9, 5.0, and a 5.4. Pretty interesting, because we go up here and we have a 5.4. So, are the 5.4s connected to one another? Sure are. We got another series of earthquakes over here in the West Pacific. Like I said, 5.5 and 5.3 were all within a hair of each other around the entire plate. That's not a coincidence across the entire planet at this point, actually. Now we go across the Caribbean and we get over to the Eastern Caribbean between Dominican Republic and Puerto Rico. And here we are. Look at the line of earthquakes here. So it's a pretty definitive line starting at the eastern edge of Dominican Republic, and it's all the same size quakes. 3.3 on one side, 3.4 on the other, and spanning across twos and threes in the middle. That's heading out this way, and we would expect the Mid-Atlantic Ridge to be compressed this week. We talked about this on Sunday night, and here we are today, and finally the Mid-Atlantic Ridge starting to get smacked around. Starting last night with Iceland up to the north, now we're all the way down to the south. South Sandwich Islands all the way to the south, Iceland all the way to the north. I would expect the areas in between to be filled in. As we go over towards Asia, look at this. Last night's 4.2 in eastern China, followed today in western China by a 4.0. The Chinese got wise to this. Chinese got wise to earthquake forecasting. In case you guys don't know, the Chinese announced this past week they're going to be doing up to 3 weeks out earthquake forecasting, based upon the measuring of stresses and tension and pressures in the plate as the stresses, pressure, and tension transfers across China. And they're going to be putting sensors, 2,000 or more sensors, to detect this pressure transfer over here in western China where our two arrows meet. And they announced this, and they're going to be putting the information out publicly so that the people in the public can forecast earthquakes, use the information to help forecast earthquakes for the people of China. I'm going to do it. I'm going to get the information. I'm going to forecast for the people in China just like I would for everybody else on the planet. And I already do, but the seismic data is limited from the USGS and EMSC. We have to go check the Chinese agency even to get earthquakes. That's kind of the kibosh that the Western countries have put on the data. That's unacceptable to me. But yeah, who am I to say anything, right? Western countries want to get into it with the Eastern countries and not share data. Fine. We will bypass that, and I will totally get into the data and look all over it. I'm not going to be biased because they have some different political beliefs, or even if they hate us. Even if you're a country that totally despises us, I'm still going to do forecasting for you because I care about knowing where things are going to go. It's like a weather system. Okay, big weather system's going to be blowing over one of the countries that doesn't like us at the moment. Maybe we should just ignore that. Oh, there's no weather there. Let's just wait. Okay. Anyway, we are looking at 4.2, 4.0 going down over the course of a day. And so here's the deal. Here's how it works. We get a push that comes across Asia. It's not that this 4.2 causes this 4.0. They're too far apart. The shaking at this location only goes out a couple hundred miles, and the shaking at the 4.0 only goes out maybe 100 miles. So they're not causing each other directly from shaking. It's a force. It's a pressure that transfers across whole regions in the course of a day, 2 days. And over the course of a short period of time, this force transfers and it will drop off similar-sized earthquakes all the way along the way. So that's why we're getting fours striking all the way across over into Europe, and our youngest earthquake now striking in Turkey. And you'll notice the halfway points are being hit, the rough halfway points on this. So 4.2 and 4.4 struck first, filled in the middle by 4.0. 5.0 and 4.4 struck first, and 4.1 filling in the rough middle. And we go further to the west, and it's the same thing going all the way across Europe. We get up into Poland, check it out, guys. Or I'm sorry, Germany, back to the German-Czech border. Another earthquake. And central Italy, starting to swarm out now, going up to near 3. So we're creeping up in magnitudes at Norcia, and we've issued our warnings already for Italy. If you're not aware, if you live in Italy, tanto amore. Tanto amore means much... Whoops, just banged my microphone there, sorry. Tanto amore means much love. Let's get my coffee. And I want you to be ready for it. You got a 5.0 down in the Aegean Sea, and you see which way the arrow points? Let me turn down the rings. Arrow points out of Greece and Turkey and goes right into Italy, over to the west across Gibraltar and out to the Azores. Also goes across Europe up to the north. People in Iceland, you were hit last night. Now, finally, let's talk about the United States. Let's talk about this. Last night's 3.7, the final carrying on of the superfracture And I shouldn't say final, it might carry on a little bit more. We're getting ready to get another little push from the West Coast. But first things first, what's going on down here in Texas? We got 4 earthquakes, or at least 2, that are double reported. And let's go pull in the coordinates from the USGS, show you what's there. We're down at a 5-kilometer depth down inside the plate in West Texas. And longtime viewers, you guys already know what's there, right? You already know what's here. Let's zoom in and show you. Back it out just ever so slightly. See this? Okay, we are on the edge of one of the largest pumping operations in the continental United States. Now, from this height, okay, first of all, we are in a county here, and out here on these roads, for instance, right here, perfect example, we've got a drill point, pipelines, we've got a burn safety apparatus to burn off any oil or gas that may overflow out of there, and these are actually sparse compared to one of, the biggest pumping operation in the continental United States. And just to give you a perspective, you may need to full screen this so you can really get the picture on what I'm showing you. Now, I'm just randomly zooming in. Okay, I'm just picking a look here. Look, they've got the derrick out there. They've got the pipelines. They've got the trucks. This imagery date 2017. And you see it all across here. Every little square pad is a different oil pumping operation where they've drilled, they have pumps, and weak points in the crust. There you go. There's another one right there. And it just goes on and on and on. So I think you get the picture. And then we get really concentrated here. So we're just, you know, a hundred feet apart, 200 feet apart on each well. And it just goes on and on like this for miles and miles and miles. Now it stops right here. And I'm not exaggerating. It quite literally stops right here where the earthquake is. And then we pick up to some volcanoes just to the west. So that's why we're getting earthquakes striking in West Texas. It's a weak point. But I want you to look at this. Here's our Craton graphic. Look at Texas. Look at the Craton graphic. Do you see anything? The Craton graphic shows it. The Craton plate, the edge of the interior portion of the plate, goes down through West Texas, makes a bend through Texas, and goes up into Oklahoma. You can also see it, again, that's marked in orangish red versus purple on the Craton diagram. Now that you've got that in your head, we'll jump back over here and see our green versus yellow. Green versus yellow is a height differential on the NOAA map. So whether I'm using the Craton graphic or you're able to see it here with your own eyes, it's a bend in the plate that goes around through Texas and comes back up into the mountain ranges of southern New Mexico. And it gets pushed. It gets pushed from the West Coast. The force travels across the plate. Now we need to go consult what's going on the West Coast, 0.0 and greater earthquake feed, last 12 hours. So everything basically since last night at 8 p.m. my time. And here we go. So you're going to see, obviously, the Midwest finally recovering from that 4.0 superfracture and a new push coming in now across Texas. But we get over to California. And our swarmage is, well, compared to where we were yesterday, is less. Yes, less. So there's less swarmage that's going on here today, which means that pressure is on the move. And it's escaping out of California and going over to the east. It's pretty obvious. That's why Texas is getting hit now. Also, last 12 hours, you're going to see it up here to the west-northwest. Nothing. I mean, what can I say? Nothing. Nothing at Yellowstone, nothing in Washington, nothing in Oregon, nothing in Northern California in 12 hours' time. While the swarms suddenly die out in California proper, or starting to die out. Now, I can name these areas for you if you guys need me to. I show them almost every night. I've got them memorized. Here is Pyramid Lake. Pyramid Lake has the Needles, Geyser Field, and Fumaroles. We go to the west, we're at Lassen Volcanic Center. We go to the west from there, southwest, we're at Clear Lake Volcano and Geysers. Single earthquake up at Eureka, and almost the exact same sized earthquake down in San Francisco. Along the creeping section of the San Andreas, south of Monterey Bay, north of Santa Barbara, kind of the halfway point between the two. And then a pumping operation, the same one that I showed you last night. Oil and gas, just like in Texas. This is the largest pumping operation in California, believe it or not. So, largest pumping operation in the country in Texas just got hit. And let's show you what's in California while I get a sip of my coffee. Now, I showed this last night. It's just kind of carrying on since last night. Here's our oil wells. And I mean, this is, you're really going to have to come in and inspect these areas if you want to get in, get up to speed on this. So we've got oil well after oil well after oil well. And it's not fracking. They try to blame fracking and wastewater injection, but it turns out it's the drill points. Look at all of them. The drill points are the weak points. Whether it's pumped full of water or gas or they're extracting, you start doing this, you're going to get release of seismic pressure when the plate gets pushed, especially if you're on an area that's next to a fault zone like this right here. I mean, come on, we're in California and you're drilling right there. We go down to the south from there and we get into a series of explosions out here in the Mojave again. And it's no shock. They're doing some mining and stuff out there. So I'm not shocked to see, you know, 1.9. But we go up to the north, the geothermal field at Volcano Peak, Devil's Kitchen, going. And this swarm over here, Las Vegas, guys. I don't know what's going on with this. This started yesterday. I thought it was explosions. They had the first one marked as an explosion. Sometime during the night, they changed them from explosions to earthquakes at what depth? Hold on. 5.5 kilometer depth. This is in Vegas. But I never knew this. And I really didn't. Castle Rock and the others, mountains just to the north, are ancient volcanoes. Now, that's not my take on it either. You're welcome to check it out. Go look up Castle Rock. It's not marked as a volcano. It's ancient. I mean, we're talking, you could probably make out the tuftage. I can't even see the tuftage on here. I mean, so if there is any kind of tuftage on the top, it's, I mean, that could be. It's so hard to tell. It's grainy. But I'm just shocked to find that out. You know, I didn't know that there was a volcano that close to Las Vegas. But that being said, it's at a 5 kilometer depth, which would be above any kind of magma chamber. I'm wondering if there's fault zones that are here that I don't know about. Maybe there's a named one that, yeah, there is. Check it out. Sheep East Desert Ranges Fault. Never heard of it before in my life, but the earthquake is right there on the fault. So that's probably what's going on there. I don't think it's related directly to the volcano, but it was marked as an explosion to begin with. And so it looked like an explosion, right? Why? Why? Well, speaking of explosions and looking like explosions, we're going to go pull this small quake at Beatty, Nevada. This is at a site. There's a reason that there's an earthquake striking here. This is not an explosion, though. Just so you know, before we go look it up. Here we are. Now, what are all these craters? All of these craters are underground nuclear test sites where we've detonated nukes underground. And I can get the information. Google Earth community has them all marked. You guys are welcome to come in and check it out. U.S. nuke Operation Hutch, July 16th, 1969. 120 kilotons. That's pretty big. And we're right next to it. And then we get over here, and this is where we let the French and the English do their nuke test. Yeah, we let the French and English do nuke test over in Nevada. Isn't that great? Joint project. Joint collab. We got a collaboration going on with these people. No, they're not doing art. They're not doing music. We're doing some nukes, you know, working on this stuff together. And and I'm not going off on anybody. I'm just saying, they owe us one. I don't ever want to hear the French or the English complain about anything U.S. because we let you do nuke test over here, which you're now using to protect your country with. As you look at the Northwest, you're going to notice the complete lack of earthquakes. There's something up with that. There's something up with that because look at what's going on with the slow slip. In the last 24 hours and 48 hours, the Northwest has gotten really pushed, and this is getting pushed by the Pacific. So this swarm of red dots, each red dot is a vibration, and the vibrations indicate that the plate's in motion. And over 24 hours, it started to die up to the north and pick up down to the south, where I got a new pocket or cluster breaking out at the California-Oregon border, directly across the border from Mount Shasta. Then going down to the south, we get down to Redding, south of Redding, and these two little clusters are ongoing in the last day. But man, 48 hours really shows it. You can see it up to the north. Big time movement just happened. It looks like I said, it's sputtering out up to the north, but no earthquakes. Usually, when you get something like this, and then it stops, it releases its energy. There's something currently pushing from off the coast, causing all of this, that pushed all of the Olympic Peninsula, that pushed all of California, that's pushed all the way to Texas. And if it can push all the way to Texas, then we're talking about a great amount of force. The same amount of force that's capable of causing an ongoing multi-week long event in Hawaii at this point. This is reaching into what I would call uncharted territories for me personally. I'm not saying it hasn't happened in the past. It has. It definitely has happened. These type of volcanic events in Hawaii. But for me, keeping track, trying to watch and see if there's any repeat patterns from 2011, for instance, for a megaquake, we're in uncharted waters now. We're going on weeks and weeks. We're getting big blasts and the craters collapsing at Kilauea. Mauna Loa is starting to move. We're spreading out from there. We're going to other volcanoes. It's taking longer. And I'm not shocked. Natural processes, there are tides and flows to things, but even those can lag, and we can have anomalies and variations that take place in there when outside events start to mix in and manipulate or influence these processes. So I am very concerned that we are still in the potential threat zone for a large earthquake. I am. I'm watching for it. I'm not telling other people to. I don't want to get everybody up in a tussle. I'm mentioning it, of course, and I'm talking about it in general, but I'm watching close. Last week it didn't hit. We are now on Friday of this week, and Hawaii's still ongoing. It's still draining. This is not like 2011. This is actually worse than 2011. In 2011, we had a collapse at Pu'u'o'o first, just like now in 2018. First Pu'u'o'o collapsed, then Kilauea drained, and they both spilled the full contents out on the landscape, on the landslide. And when that happened, it all happened pretty much at once in the course of a few days' time. So it was just a huge lava flow, fountains of it coming out everywhere, flowing over cliff tops like a waterfall. It was amazing. And they got it on helicopter. It went on for a couple days. Then that was on the 5th and 6th of March 2011. Then on March 11th, so like 5 days later, the big Japan megaquake happened. Well, it's been more than 5 days. It's been a week and a half. It's ongoing. So in 2011, in 2011, even though the lava lake drained and so forth, it did not have any explosions. There were no, hold on. They've adjusted the magnitude at Mauna Loa to 2.9. Someone is reviewing the earthquake information. They've adjusted the magnitude down by a point, which means someone somewhere is aware of this earthquake that's happening at Mauna Loa. All right. Okay, so I think you're starting to get the picture here. In 2011, it drained, but there were no explosions, and there was no reports of any threats of explosions. So we're talking about a deeper drain at this point where things are falling off and falling down and causing big blasts. It's a good time to have an earthquake plan, guys. Have an earthquake plan. Also, you could have a volcano plan, but your volcano plan is pretty much going to be evacuate if you need to. But in the earthquake situation, you need to be able to take shelter almost immediately. If it's a large earthquake, like what hit in Hawaii or what can hit globally, you need to, of course, know to take shelter. If you're in a brick or a cinder block house, any kind of stone-stacked house or structure, you need to think about having an exit plan if you start feeling an earthquake. As soon as you start feeling the earthquake, you start heading towards the exit. You don't want to stick around to find out if it's a big earthquake in a brick or a cinder block house or structure. Whole sections of the walls can fall in a few seconds' time in those types of structures. Frame structures are a little bit different. A lot of frame structures stay standing even in very large earthquakes, but the interiors of the houses are completely knocked around and everything's knocked over and things break and fall. And so you can make plans to prepare for that now by having a sturdy table or desk that you get under in case you need to. And then also, if you're a very proactive person, you'll develop a bug out bag or emergency kit that has one day's worth of supplies the first day of any disaster. And you'll come up with all sorts of creative things to put into that backpack or satchel that you've got set off to the side. I would recommend putting it somewhere that's pretty close to your exit so that if you have to grab it on the way out, you can, or after the event is over, you know where to easily find it to go get it and get the things out of it that you need. And of course, everybody's different, but there's a few basic items you're going to probably want to put in: flashlight, batteries, first aid kit, sanitation, extra change of clothes, maybe a set of shoes, form of communication, or a way to charge your communication device. And you may want to think about an extra ID, insurance card, set of keys. We've already mentioned these things a trillion times. I'll tell you one more. I'll be back if anything else goes down. What more proof do you need? I mean, Iceland has now been hit within the magnitude of what hit in South Europe. So South Europe got hit by a 5, and then a 4.2 travels across the region and hits it all the way at the termination point. Or the halfway points are being hit in between in China. Or over here, all the fulcrum points, halfway point between a halfway point between a halfway point. So what's happening? These areas are dividing in half, and then they're dividing in half again, and then they're dividing in half again, and each halfway point is getting hit in between. Now that you understand that, now that you understand our halfway fulcrum points are hit, and we're hit by the combined total of everything on both sides, or all sides, it removes the mystery of earthquakes and replaces it with vigilance. You can now watch this like watching a storm. And I'm going to save this as a video over on YouTube so that people can see it in the future and make note of what's going on. We're at a time of seismic unrest. Things are increasing. Why are things increasing? We had a round of deep earthquakes that have been ongoing for a month. And this round of deep earthquakes, or this deep earthquake event, as I've been calling it, is now in the 130 range, 130 different deep earthquakes in the last month down below the plates. That has put us into serious motion. It's what's led to Hawaii. It's what's led to the other volcano. I haven't even checked the Volcanic Ash Advisory Center. Let's go check it out. Let's go check it out together before we go. Volcanic Ash Advisory Center. Oh, look who's on the list. Mount Sinabung and Turrialba. How about that, guys? I just correctly forecast my first volcanic eruption. All right, Turrialba has erupted, and they've detected the signals there. Now, it's not observed. They haven't observed it with satellite yet. We'll wait and see what's observed. We'll read the list. Sabankaya in Peru, Dukono in Indonesia, Sinabung in western Indonesia, Turrialba in Costa Rica, Kilauea, possible ongoing emissions, Sakurajima, Sabankaya, Dukono, Sakurajima, Reventador, Popocatepetl, Turrialba. Reports of volcanic ash. All right. So we do have reports. Kilauea, Sabankaya, Lengila, Sakurajima, and then we get into yesterday. So here's what's going on. I don't normally forecast eruptions, but yesterday there were a series of threes. I talked about it in last night's update. You can go watch it on my YouTube channel. There were a series of threes that broke out across Costa Rica. And at the same time that was going on, Popocatépetl had some fours that struck next to it in Mexico. And I said, well, look, okay, we got fours striking on both sides of Popo, and Popo's erupting. These threes down here are a sign that we're going to be seeing an eruption, maybe tomorrow. And here we are today, and Turrialba's on the list. And we got a 5.4 next to it. So what more proof do you need? Forces oh, here's something else. Turrialba, the halfway point between this 4.5 and this 5.4. Boom. Eruption. Another fulcrum point hit in between. I'm going to save this as a video now so people can see in the future. And I'm not going to start forecasting volcanoes, guys. I just tell you when I see it. I've got a lot on my plate right now. I don't need to be doing volcanoes on top of everything else. We'll do that down the road after we conquer this one. All right, guys, you are great. Thank you for tuning in, and I'll be back if anything else goes down. We'll see you back here tonight at 10 p.m. Central Time, hopefully, if nothing else happens between now and then. Peace out.